will I say that this video game collection, this hoard, dying with it, gave me the same amount of pleasure, enrichment in my life. So you have to ask, are these brothers gonna cash in on their investment? Are they gonna cash in on that foresight? AKA Mr. Gaming Guns, or as I like to call him, AKA Mr. Lips.
Naughty.
60K American Casey can buy my entire video game collection. You can get a commission, 5%. That's like 3K. I'm pretty sure that's right. What up, YouTube? Welcome to the show, the weekly vlog where we discuss all things life and the state of the video game collection. We call it the Horde. I have not named the show yet. I will, I promise. But on today's episode, we discuss...
What do we discuss today?
We contemplate dying with your video game collection. I ask your help in helping me determine when is it appropriate to replace or repair things on your authentic video game items. And I, the filthy reseller, put up some bangers on eBay for my personal collection. My precious. Before we get into anything, I have to thank everybody who commented on last week's video. It gives me limitless energy. There was a lot of really awesome supportive comments on last week's video especially. You guys don't know how much it means to me, honestly. A few of them popped up while I was being a little bitch at the gym. Really helped me get through. And actually, there was one comment, a really positive comment, that came up just as I was at work and something was bringing like my energy level down. I mean, I let something at work bring me down. Fuck it. Instant power up. Bulletproof.
Hit me with a bat.
So as always, thank you guys so much. You're the reason why I love coming back to YouTube and making these videos. And don't forget, Queen 8 will always be there for you right on this show. S4G, Striving for Greatness. That was actually one of the front runners for what I was going to call this weekly vlog. Didn't resonate with me fully. I'm still working on it though. We're gonna work on it. So before we get into the state of the video game collection, let's discuss this thing that we all do called life. So this week for me, a little bit somber. We had to close down the trailer for the season, so it's the last time we're gonna be there this year, and we're not gonna see it again until the beginning of spring next year. A little bit sad. You know, I was thinking about the time we spent out there this summer, and I have to say that out of all the pickups in my life, of course, I mean material things, not my family and my wife. Out of all the pickups in my life, that trailer has to be like the greatest maple syrup pickup ever. Like, this summer was so relaxing out there. Life was just easier. There's so many problems, especially that I'm getting older. I feel like the problems kind of pile up, but when you're out there, life's good, man. You feel God out in the country. And my kids, especially, they get to live life like kids. You know, they're biking around, they're in the great outdoors, they have a lot of friends there, a lot of friendly people. I don't worry that someone's gonna come and abduct them. It's a very safe community. I remember being my son's age and like being mugged for my winter jacket. Like, seriously, man. You know, I got a lot of weird stories like that. I should start like a story time on this vlog. Yeah, next week, story time with Queen 8, we're gonna do it. But now that school is back in session, we're just getting back into the swing of things. The routine is really kicking in now, which is nice. It's really helping me, the structure, to go back to the gym. But along with that, the stresses of life kind of hit you in the face. You can only escape it for so long, but thank God we're f***ing bulletproof. It's a concept I've been thinking about, actually. Making myself bulletproof. No, I came up with that myself. That's original. Maybe it was inspired by a book or something that I read, but the concept of making yourself bulletproof, physically, emotionally, we're going to talk more about it. I think that is a worthwhile endeavor. So last video we were discussing about the balance of being a game collector, a video gamer, and life, right? There's a nice balance there, and especially your comments in the comments below really forcing me to examine this thing from a totally different perspective. It affects me. Like, I really think about that a lot. And it's funny, if not suspicious, how in my YouTube feed the video that I need will pop up just when I need it, you know?
This calls for a celebration.
That algorithm. Oh. Hi, China. I love China. Huawei is my favorite phone. Again, I'm not having a midlife crisis. I just want a motorcycle. But there was this video that came up from Get the Greg Games. AKA Mr. Gaming Guns. Or as I like to call him, AKA Mr. Lips.
Naughty.
Some of you might know this story already, but in his video he was discussing about the Dallas-Fort Worth collection. Essentially, it's a story about two brothers who back in the 80s were like the original sealed video game collectors. They were buying these games new, like Nintendo games, Super Nintendo games, with the rule of two, as we called it in the shoe collecting world. You know, one to rock, one to stock. And as Greg says in his video, it's as organic can get in terms of collectability or collecting. So you fast forward years later, these same games are being graded, being slabbed, and put up for auction in what they're calling the Dallas-Fort Worth Collection. And I mean, these are like cream of the crop games, right? Early Nintendo titles, desirable Nintendo titles. So you have to ask, are these brothers gonna cash in on their investment? Are they gonna cash in on that foresight that they had way back in the 80s? Lucky for us, the auction already happened, and you can see the results here. A lot of these games selling for thousands, tens of thousands of dollars. There's a lot of money here. But I think it's safe to say that the auction itself was a success. Sadly, however, the two brothers would not see a dime of this, nor would they even know how well received these items that they've held on for so long were received into the community, into whatever. Because I'm sure, as most of you already know, the two brothers died way before this auction even happened. And their estate, who is in charge of managing all their fangs after they passed away, actually sold these games raw and put them into the hands of like these other people who, I guess, knew the market already. And those guys ended up paying like pennies on the eventual dollars that these games ultimately got. To me, that's like a really sad thought. You know, I would have loved to have met these brothers, to interview them, you know, ask them, why did they do this? What did it mean to them? All the years of them holding on to these games. A brotherly love, Mamusha. I would have loved to just ask them, like, what was game buying or collecting like back then in the 80s? Because I was really young. I was born in 84, right? So, and I think it hit me like right here in the good old heart container, because I see myself in those brothers. You know, the fact of the matter is, any of us could die tomorrow, right? Like tomorrow, I could be hit by a car. And I would feel bad for hurting that car. But imagine if it was like a bus or a plane that hit me. That might be enough to, you know, game over Tito Nate here. That's so sad. At my wife's 40th birthday, the kids were calling me Tito Nate. I'm not Kuya anymore. I'm too old. And this is where the conversation, I think, gets a little tough, as Greg puts it in his video. What would come of the hoard were I to die? I would like to think my wife is aware more than most about the value of my collection. Actually, it's really funny. I had a conversation with Ian and Lester, I don't know how many years ago, where I said, if I ever predeceased you guys, it's your job, Ian and Lester, to sell my video game collection, top dollar, give that money to my family. And I know that's not a great plan, but I think it's important to think about, right? What are you gonna do? It's good to plan for it now. It relieves a lot of stress, right? Maybe talk to your family ahead of time about what these items are worth. Perhaps getting them appraised, insured, making sure if it's that massive or that substantial, it's in your final will and testament. Because like in the case of those two brothers, I really wish they would have gotten top dollar for their items, at least for their family, if they had family, for their estate. Fucking Michael Keaton out here, vultures, man. But in those last days while we were closing down the trailer, like, I was thinking about this quite a bit. I pondered on it a lot, like in front of the fire, in front of the lake. Like, what if that armored bus, jet-powered bus full of escaped convicts is about to hit me? Because that would be what it takes to kill me.
Why couldn't you put the bunny back in the box?
In that split second just before that bus hits me, and like my whole life flashes before my eyes and I ponder every decision I made in my life, will I say that this video game collection, this hoard, dying with it gave me the same amount of pleasure, enrichment in my life as the monetary equivalent of what it's worth, including like the time I spent procuring these items, taking care, storing these items, mental energy I spent on it? Was it worth it at the end of the day? That's honestly a very scary question for me. Again, not a midlife crisis. I just want a motorcycle. And I think it's important to remember that a good life is seldom done by accident, right? You got to think of all those decisions. If you could look back, say you're on your deathbed and you could look back, what were those decisions, those choices you made in your life that could have made the difference? I think that's a very important exercise that I probably don't do enough. You know, I would recommend other people do it. Just think about your life as like one big story and you're already at the end. What do you want that story to say, right? And now you're in an advantageous position. You're here now. You're not there yet. You can write that story as time goes. Yes, there are things we cannot control, but we don't worry about that. Fucking bulletproof. But my goal right now isn't to tell you like what's right for you. Heck, I don't even know what's right for me. The point of this was just to kind of explore that topic. Get your insights in the comments below. Help me think of it from a different perspective. You know, I'm not saying I hate video games. Like I feel like it has enriched my life. To what degree? Still deciding that. But my goal for this segment was to just start that conversation and to think deeply about it, because as we should know, a good life is usually lived on purpose. See, that's a queen eight. You see what I did there? Lived on purpose, because you're purposely making decisions to enrich and better your life, but you're also living your life for a purpose. Huh? Pretty good, right? So I'm assuming, as I'm sure that most of you are the same level of life that I am, you're probably, you know, the questions that are going through my head and are going through yours. So we'll ponder on this as we go along here in the weekly vlogs that we shoot. But remember, 60K American Casey can buy my entire video game collection. Drive down, pick it up, it's all yours. Slab games, consoles. I have a closet. I don't know how much money is in that thing. I have this app that tells you like the value of your entire video game collection. And just my video games alone is like 82,000 American. So 60K, you're going to be getting everything. That's a deep discount. I didn't even factor in my consoles and anything and everything. Lots of stuff in there. Buy it now. Sight unseen. And I will say this. If you refer somebody who actually comes and pays 60K for my collection, you can get a commission. 5%. That's like 3K. I'm pretty sure that's right. I'm not great at math or spelling. Now, since we already touched on video games anyways, let's just get into it. The State of the Horde, where we discuss all things, all the happenings in the video game collection. So, continuing on from last week's video, name of the game is just listing on eBay. I'm still preparing for Q4, as we call it in the reseller world. The fourth quarter of the year is usually when all the big sales happening. So my goal is to just keep listing. I was listing all my doubles. That was like how I got started revamping my eBay store. But I set a goal last week to list $50 a day worth of items on eBay. And my stock of doubles and stuff is running pretty low. So this week I actually had to start dipping into my main collection. Best NWO member of all time, Conan. Tell me I'm wrong. Sold out, where we look at items that are exiting the Horde, exiting the collection, never to be seen again. So like I said, I had to dip into the collection to fulfill my target of $50 a day. I was able to maintain that pace, but it was a lot harder than I thought, right? Especially because my supply was running low for doubles. And it really forced me to reflect on what kind of gamer am I? What kind of collector am I? So I'm just going to show on the screen here some of the bangers that I've been listing, dipping into my main collection. And in self-reflection, I realize I'm not an RPG gamer. I mean, yes, there are like the same 5 or 6 RPGs I'm going to be playing over and over again until I'm dead. But in the grand scheme of things, I'm not going to be playing Xenosaga. Like, I got all three here. Still factory sealed because I bought them new. I still haven't played them yet, right? It's a lot of time and effort that goes into an RPG. And the older I'm getting, the less I want to spend my time on that type of stuff. I also realized, as much as I love Resident Evil, I'm not really a fan of horror games. Like Silent Hill, man, I can't play Silent Hill. That game fucks with my brain way too deeply. I will not be able to sleep after playing it. I could kick some zombies' asses in Res 4, right? But you put on fucking Fatal Frame, dead Asian faces scare me. Times Square can't shine as bright as you. I swear it's true. And the more that I thought about it, the one like set, the one collection that is probably gonna, you know, be purged from the Horde first, likely is gonna be my PSP collection. I barely play the PSP, but there's one game I'm gonna keep, and that's the complete, I don't know what you call it, the complete collection. The most definitive way to play Final Fantasy IV. I mean, this is probably like the best collection for a game that I love personally. Final Fantasy II, as I'm gonna call it, because that's what we got in North America. One of my favorite RPGs of all time. I've played every re-release of that game, but at least I realize now I'm not really an RPG guy or a horror fan. I like pick up and play games like beat 'em ups and stuff. I'm an arcade gamer, I think, at heart. But going forward into the next week, the name of the game will stay the same. Rhymed. It's just going to be listing. I want to get as much listings on my eBay store as I can in preparation for Q4. I also, interestingly enough, I just finished, they have an onboarding video. If you want to start selling on WhatsApp, it's a very interesting concept to me. Selling, like live selling. And if I did do that, I think the best way to approach it was my main focus will not be trying to make as much money as I can off of it. I would love to just have a job where I go out, look for interesting items to curate a collection for a show. I think that would be so much fun. Is it the future of selling? I don't know, Riff.
Move this man! Move!
I used his code actually to get started on WhatsApp. So hey, you're welcome. I probably gave you, I don't know how much the referral money is. Queen 8 to you, Riff. But let's put a cap on being a filthy reseller. Let's focus on items that are staying in the hoard, the state of the video game collection. It's funny, actually, the more I've been selling things, I think I said it on a previous video, the more I'm getting rid of like my doubles and triples, the more I'm beginning to cherish the items that are remaining, which is kind of a nice way to think about your collection. Quality over quantity. But it also leaves me in a kind of a precarious state. I'm a little bit more scared. Because if, like, say, one disc breaks down or one disc has disc rot, I don't have any more backups to replace that one. Where before I would have doubles of games that I really like. So now that these games are more or less going to be staying in my collection, I really have to start taking better care of them. So I ordered a couple supplies online. My goal is to replace all the batteries for games that have one on their PCBs. We got to protect ourselves, make our games bulletproof from acid rot.
Fatality.
Reptile has no power here. I bought a bunch of cartridge protectors for my SNES games. You can see I have a lot of them loose right on a wall over there. I'm hoping that this will provide them a little bit of extra protection. I'm noticing some of the wear, probably from handling the games. But what I'm really excited about are these I got from Etsy. Replacement video game labels. And this is where I need some of your input, some of your help. For me, it's kind of blasphemous to destroy the original components of a video game, namely video game labels. I believe that you should keep the item, despite its condition, as authentic as possible. But at what point is it acceptable to replace like a video game label? How damaged does it have to be? How much wear has to be shown before you rip that sucker off and put a new replacement one on? But here's an example of one game that I want to replace the label on. The TMNT 3 for the Game Boy. It's actually a really fun game. Very pricey too, actually. But the one I have here, the label's pretty beat. Again, Queen 8 loves a deal. Sometimes that comes with crappy labels like this. I think this is a pretty clear contender for something that I could refurbish? Is that the right word? I got this really cool like holographic sticker. And I like this because it kind of points out the fact that this is a reproduction. It's not obviously just trying to copy something, like scan it and put it back on. That might try to fool somebody. This is obviously holographic. It never came like that originally. And I think it's important. If the game's going to stay in my collection, it has to be in a state that I can appreciate it. And I think this one's pretty bad. Let me know in the comments below. Would you leave this label or would you replace it? Now here's another one that has a little bit of a kind of odd type of label damage. Somebody tried to use hot glue on this Fievel Goes West cartridge. Again, a little bit more pricey, this cartridge. I don't even know. How could you fix this? Does anybody know? Would you try to fix this? Or would you replace this one? Is this level of label damage acceptable to replace? Or do I keep this as is? Let me know what you think in the comments below. Of course, I'm going to do what I want. I implore you guys to do the same. Going forward, as I, you know, start to take better care of these games, maybe refurbishing them, I'll show you guys here some of the improvements I've made. Because if it's going to stay on my shelf, I want it to look great, but I gotta put the work in. You can see here the Faxandu manual. Yes, I'm calling it Faxandu. One of my favorite games of all time. You saw it in last week's pickup video. It came with a manual that was pretty rough. And I watched a couple videos on how people iron press comic books at home. So I kind of tried to use the same tactics that they used. And I think it turned out pretty good. I know some people might scoff or might cringe at how I'm doing this, but the end result is not bad. It's a pleasure to leaf through this manual again. One thing I did do, however, that I think maybe is kind of overboard was I did a staple replacement. I had to try to put the staple through these papers that were all shifting and moving around. I probably caused more hole wear. That didn't sound good to this manual. Thankfully, it came out really good at the end. The pages are all tight. But yeah, if anyone out there has some manuals, I think it's worthwhile to iron them out, make them look nice and pristine. I've been really thinking about this concept of becoming bulletproof, and I don't know how it hit me, but I think just because I've been thinking about it a lot, I said think a lot there, just because it's been on my mind a lot. You know, basically you look at something that's inadequate in your life, some important aspect, and then you fix it. You make it bulletproof. You know, a while ago, I had this one worry where, you know, if I passed away, how would my family survive without me? I know they'd be devastated internally, but as a provider, as financially. But boom, many years ago, I got life insurance, and I'm so thankful that I did now, because it'd be harder to apply for that now. But there, my family is taken care of in the event of my death. Financially bulletproof. Physically bulletproof. If my family ever needed me, can I spring into action? Right? That means I gotta take care of my body. I gotta make sure my blood pressure is good, my sleep is good. I have the strength of 10 men. So that way nobody messes with us. Physically bulletproof. Thank you guys very much for joining me. I commit to being here again next week. I commit to trying to make this show better. We're going to name the show next week. But let me know in the comments below. Suggestions, questions, jabs. Give me your best shot. Again, you guys make this whole thing worthwhile to me. I might as well be talking to myself if it wasn't for you. So thank you guys very much. Truly. Queen 8, you make me bulletproof. S4G, strive for greatness, everybody. And before we go, the quote of the week, Kuya Nate say. What does Kuya Nate say? Talking about the future here. The best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time to plant a tree, today. Chinese proverb, Kuya Nate. Thank you guys very much for watching. Peace, take care of yourselves and each other. Let's get it. Seriously, your guys' comments, because we're the majority of the people watching this, I think, are my demographic, going through the same thoughts, midlife crisis. I know I joke, I don't have one. I have one. So looking at things from your perspective, especially if you've been through it already, it's so invaluable, honestly. And the motivating words, like, I'm honest when I say there was some work drama happening. You know, it's a tough time at work. And then somebody's comment really helped pull me up that day. That was awesome. S4G. I was thinking about that for the naming this weekly vlog, right? S4G, striving for greatness. I was inspired by Dwight Schrute's speech that he gave on The Office there. I think that'd be funny. A funny name for the show. But it didn't make the final cut, sadly. I want something simple, like the hammer or men are forged. Something, one word, right? Like an app name. Welcome to Oak. Welcome to Pixel Squad. Lester had a good one. Nate C, the Game Genie. Totally original. I love arcade one-ups. Hey! Queen Nate wants all the smoke. Oh, anyways, peace. Take care, you guys. DK all day. Let's go.